The famous Nobel laureate Richard Feynman told an interesting story in his physics lectures at Caltech.
Richard Feynman's high school teacher noticed that Feynman was bored in class. The teacher decided to pique Feynman's interest with a new concept in physics. He said to the student, "I'll show you something interesting." Years later, while giving his famous lectures at Caltech, Feynman recalled this incident.
Then he told me about something which I found absolutely fascinating, and have since then always find fascinating. Every time the subject comes up, I work on it. In fact, when I began to prepare this lecture, I found myself making more analyses on the thing. Instead of worrying about the lecture, I got involved in a new problem. This is the principle of least action.
This principle asserts that there is a fundamental quantity that nature minimizes in every motion. A planet orbiting the sun, a tree leaf falling to the ground, a viola string vibrating, they all move to minimize a certain fundamental quantity.
When the French philosopher and mathematician Maupertuis presented the principle in the mid-18th century, he endured a scathing criticism from his peers, D'Alembert, Voltaire, Lagrange, because his philosophical idea was more metaphysical than rational.
In fact, Johann Koenig accused Maupertuis of stealing the idea from Leibniz. He showed a part of a letter from Leibniz, alluding to the principle. The polemic was so tense to the extent that the king ordered a search for the letter. And when Maupertuis was appointed as the president of the Royal Academy of Berlin, Koenig returned his diploma to the academy.
It was not resolved until Lagrange provided a rigorous mathematical proof of the principle. However, the proof showed that the action could be maximized or minimized.
So while Lagrange's proof stamped the principle of least action with a seal of mathematical rigor, it detracted from its beauty, because the action is not minimum all the time. The least is a misnomer.
Since the period of the Renaissance, geometers were relating concepts of mechanics to optimization. You can find several minimization principles in this period.
In particular, Gauss presented a beautiful principle about least constraints.
Any particle has its own free motion. If unforced, it'll move along a straight line, and if forced, it'll follow the applied forcing.
However, if the particle is constrained, then it will deviate from its free motion. Why? Because of the constraint. So if the deviation is only because of the constraint, it must be the least deviation that satisfies the constraint. Nature will not overdo it.
In other words, the constraint force, which exists only to ensure the constraint, causing a deviation from the free motion, must be a minimum at every instance in time. If the constraint can be ensured with a smaller force, that will happen.
For example, the free motion of the pendulum mass is falling under the action of gravity. However, it is constrained to move along a circle. This circular path constraint is ensured by the force in the pendulum rod. This force exists only because of the constraint. So according to Gauss's principle, it must be minimum at every instant in time. It is the least force required to ensure the constraint.
The deviation between the free motion and the actual constrained motion looks like a residual from a least squares perspective. So minimizing such a deviation is one form of least squares minimization. In fact, Gauss wrote,
"It is quite remarkable that nature modifies free motions incompatible with the necessary constraints in the same way in which the calculating mathematician uses least squares."
So, inspired by his own method of least squares, Gauss proposed a general principle in mechanics in which nature solves a least squares problem at every instant of time to determine the best evolution from the current state to the next state.
Unfortunately, Gauss's principle doesn't enjoy a fame similar to that of the principle of least action. In fact, Hoppus Tavridides wrote,
"In most of the 20th century English literature, GP, or Gauss principle, has been barely tolerated as a clever but essentially useless academic curiosity when it was mentioned at all."
Interestingly, unlike the principle of least action, where the action can be maximum or minimum, Gauss principle is a true minimum principle. The constraint force must be minimum at every instant in time.
This simple and intuitive concept, due to Gauss, has led to a very interesting minimization principle for incompressible fluid mechanics, the principle of minimum pressure gradient.
Since for incompressible flows, the internal pressure force exists only to ensure the continuity constraint, it must be minimum at every instant in time according to Gauss' principle.
It is the least pressure force that ensures continuity.
So the magnitude of the pressure gradient force over the domain must be minimum at every instant in time.
Among all possible flows that satisfy the continuity constraint, the correct flow is the one with the least pressure force.
If you could create a universe from scratch, what could you do that is simpler or more beautiful?
Interestingly, the simple concept resolved a long-standing dilemma related to one of the most fundamental questions in aerodynamics: how airplanes fly.
This is the simplest question in aeronautics: how to compute lift over a two-dimensional wing. It's not an airplane, it's not a three-dimensional wing. It can't be simpler than this. Yet, our theoretical capability is quite limited.
The main challenge in answering this question lies in the fact that the Euler equations that govern the motion of ideal fluids do not have a unique solution. Each solution results in a different value of lift. This predicament faced the early pioneers of aerodynamics, and different schools responded differently.
Right before, during, and after World War I, there was a parallel mathematical war between the Cambridge School of Mathematical Physics, led by Raleigh, Lamb, Taylor, and Bairstow, and the Göttingen School of Technical Mechanics, led by Prandtl, Kutta, Monk, and Blasius.
The Cambridge School found it useless to give focus to the theory of ideal fluids and Euler's equations. They wanted to solve the Navier-Stokes equation.
The German school followed a different path. They looked closely at the many solutions of Euler's equation.
Since our typical wing aerofoil sections have sharp trailing edges, all solutions have singularities at the sharp edges, except one.
This is the unique solution picked up by Kutta and Joukowsky, leading to the celebrated Kutta-Joukowsky condition.
So the Göttingen School won the mathematical war and succeeded in developing a theory of lift that enabled aviation and is currently taught in all engineering schools throughout the world, including Cambridge.
The story had a happy end when Prandtl was invited to receive the gold medal from the Royal Aeronautical Society in London and give the Wright Memorial Lecture.
Prandtl was astute in his lecture to address the concerns of the British school. His paper was titled, "The Generation of Vortices in Fluids of Small Viscosity,"
which demonstrates how vortex sheets and lift may generate without invoking the concept of viscosity.
Although the choice made by the British school was well justified, it didn't turn out to be a fruitful approach. A century later, we still can't routinely solve Navier-Stokes equations.
However, some concerns of the Cambridge School remain valid. Kutta's theory of lift is quite fragile. If we have a smooth wing section without a sharp edge, Kutta's dominant theory that we teach all over the world and discussed in every single textbook in aerodynamics suddenly collapses. In this case, there is no theoretical model that can predict lift.
This question remained open for a century.
Here, the principle of minimum pressure gradient provides a simple answer. From all solutions of Euler's equation, nature picks the one that minimizes the pressure gradient cost.
When we apply this principle to an airfoil with a sharp trailing edge, we recover the special case of Kutta's solution. But unlike Kutta's theory, we can obtain lift over smooth shapes without sharp edges in the exact same way.
This minimization approach is more complete than the century-old theory of lift by Kutta and Joukowsky. It's derived from first principles, and it's applicable to any shape, not just an airfoil with a sharp edge.
It may seem that the minimization principle is only an academic curiosity, but understanding how lift is generated from first principles is important for designing wings.
For example, in 1917, Einstein designed a wing shape based on the idea that increasing the wing's arc would create more lift. It didn't. Understanding that lift originates to minimize the curvature of the airflow will enable us to generate fresh insights and keep us from designing airfoils with the wrong shape.
The principle of minimum pressure gradient also enables solving the rotating cylinder problem without having to worry about the complex details of the boundary layer. The minimizing solution turned out to be exactly the same solution as Glauert's approximation of Navier-Stokes when viscosity is taken to zero, that is, Reynolds number goes to infinity.
This interesting result suggests that the principle of minimum pressure gradient may shed light on some open problems in mathematics, like convergence of Navier-Stokes to Euler.
It may also help develop novel computational algorithms for fluid mechanics by doing pure minimization, following Gauss's philosophy, rather than a brute force simulation using Navier-Stokes.
The principle may aid in developing a new theory of hydrodynamic stability. A solution is stable if it minimizes the pressure gradient cost. Otherwise, nature would choose a solution with less cost.
As George Pollio once said, describing Archimedes' discovery of integral calculus, it so happens that one of the greatest discoveries of all times was guided by physical intuition. Thank you.